Roll for Crit is brought to you by our Patreon supporters. Come roll with us at patreon.com/rollforcrit.
Welcome and join us as we discuss and decide our top 10 favorite deck building games.
Deck building is a mechanic that you'll find in many different card games, and we are defining it as follows: any game in which you are customizing and or improving your own personal deck of cards during gameplay, throughout the game as you are playing it, as seen in games like, well, I won't list any. You'll find some good recommendations that we'll go through in just a minute. We have narrowed it down each to a list of 10. It is a big genre. There are a lot of candidates, but it's very exciting because it is a genre that we're both fans of. I know especially you, Will, really love deck building games in general.
It's an easy mechanic that once you sort of played in one game, you know a lot of the strategies to bring to other games. So it's a great way for you to enter the board game world and just be able to play a lot of different games without having to go through too many rule books.
That is true. So if you are a new person to the genre of deck building, or if you just want to see where your favorites land on our lists, hopefully you'll enjoy the rest of this video. I will kick it off with my number 10 pick, Shadowrun Crossfire. This is a cooperative deck building game based off of the Shadowrun setting from role-playing games. It's a cyberpunk world, and you're working together to try to pull off heists or defeat various types of enemies that include magic and technology elements. This is a tough game. It is a difficult game that really requires teamwork. I think it has a really interesting mechanic in how the enemies are dealt with and how damage is done to them. And you have to discuss with your teammates how and when you should be dealing with those enemies. And there's also a kind of a light campaign element where as you go, you'll be progressing and marking down different stats from the end of each mission, whether it was successful or not. A unique way of going about it. I enjoy cooperative games as well, and just such a cool, cool setting. Have yet to try out Shadowrun itself as an RPG, but my introduction to it in other games has been a lot of fun.
Starting off my list at number 10 is a bit of an unusual one, but one that I love regardless. That is the T-Dragon Society card game from Renegade Game Studios. This game is based on the comic with the same name, in which there are adorable little dragons in tea, and this is a deck-building game, but unlike other ones, instead of drawing cards for a hand, it's a bit more push your luck. When you draw cards, you put them up out into your tableau area, and while there are positive cards to help you out, there are also negative cards that may say, discard a certain other card in play along with this one, meaning you'll have less cards out available. Pretty much, instead of having a turn with a hand of cards and trying to play with that, you sort of can build up to buy something bigger, maybe buy right away to get something else that would help your deck later on. If you can't tell from the art style and just the general nature of the comic, it's just really cute, calming, and I just enjoy it a lot for the game in the small box. It's just a lot of fun, and it's one of those games that I just like to play. You know, just because it's nice. It's not like the, oh, I want to find out every single permutation, best strategies. It's just nice to sit around and have a chance to play this, maybe with a nice cup of tea. Moving on to my number 9, though, is Theamaki. This game from Peterson Games is a weird fusion of poker, drafting, and deck building. The idea behind the game is that you are all gods rivaling and trying to prove you are the best one by betting your worshippers. You're going to be putting worshippers like poker into sort of a center pot, but if you lose, you do lose your worshippers. If you win, you get to keep the ones that you bet with. The winner will also get first pick at new cards to add to their deck from a lineup. So I thought this was really fun because it combines so many weird elements. The god aspect is really cool. A lot of crazy ones. I mean, look, it's Peterson Games. You know there's going to be some Cthulhu representation there. But we've also got like Greek gods, I think like some Russian ones in there. There's some Aztecs.
There's a couple different versions of that, aren't there?
There are different box sets, but pretty much they can combine with whatever you want. Like a lot of the deck building games here on both of our lists, I'm guessing, you know, there are going to be big families of games you can just mash together to use whichever cards you'd like.
Yeah, yeah, that seems to be a common thing. Deck building is an easy one to reskin, it seems, or to adapt. People like to do that a lot. All right, well, that brings us over back to me again, and it's my number 9. And number 9 on my list is Fort, which you just heard us talk about because it was in discussion for our top 10 lists of 2020. This is a new one from Leader Games. You are all kids trying to compete to build the biggest, coolest fort. And the way the deck building works in this one is really interesting because most of the building you're doing, or at least a good chunk of it, I guess it depends how you play, is coming from cards other players used, not just a central lineup that is available for all players to choose from. So you're going to be not only adding new cards to your deck, but also taking old cards from other players and giving them some cards that were previously in your deck. So it's a very communal thing. You're swapping cards all over the place. You know, make sure you use hand lotion after you're done. But it's a really unique take of something that I haven't seen really in any other deck building games, and with an adorable theme. And it's Fort. All right. Then next is my number 8 pick. And this one is an interesting one. It is called Hardback. It is the successor to Paperback. Both very similar games, and I almost could have maybe like put them as a double feature here and cheated a little bit, but I went with Hardback as my official pick. They are deck-building games in which you are attempting to spell out words. Your cards are letters, and on your turn, you're playing those letters to form words and getting victory points based on how good they are, how long the words are. Hardback, I think, is a little bit better. I think I like it a little more. It is definitely more deck building. Now cards have suits, so you're incentivized to collect cards of the same type. It also makes a lot of, you can play cards as wilds, so it's much harder to get stuck on a letter. I think it's a really cool one for people who are into word games. Paperback, I'd say, is a little more about the letters and words. Hardback is a little more on the deck building side, which I think is also why I feel it's more appropriate for this list. But it does a lot of cool stuff and has a lot of cool different modes and a theme about words and writing, which I like. So that's Hardback, my number 8.
My number 8 is going to Eminent Domain. This is a space-themed deck-building game in which you'll be conquering planets and getting more advanced technology, which of course will be cards added to your deck. But the big reason I think this deserves a slot on my list is the leader and followership mechanics that the game has. You see, when you want to do an action and gain cards and stuff, usually it's going to have you, well, be a leader, and other people can choose to follow suit. This means that even on outside your turn, you'll be getting and being able to do things. And you're also going to have to make decisions on, do I want this because my neighbor also wants to do this action and I'm just giving him an advantage? Maybe I should wait till he buys the card and then I follow him. Or maybe you customize your deck knowing that you're often going to be following a certain play style. I think it just keeps the game more engaged and stop it from being a sort of everyone's doing their own little solo game, which some deck builders can turn out to be.
Fort does the same thing, a similar thing at least. And yeah, I think we both like that mechanic a lot.
Number 7 for me is also Fort. I thought it had a lot of fun stuff. The fact that you can buy from your opponents, I think, is very interesting. And then, of course, for you, you're going to have to be thinking, I want to play this card, but then it's not going to be put back in my deck and my opponent's going to be able to buy it and then he'll use it and maybe find a way to keep it. So it really makes you think a little bit differently than what you're used to. And just like the Tea Dragon Society, they're both much smaller boxes. And won't be the only one on my list, but I enjoy the fact that it's not in a titanic collection to carry these games with you at the very least.
My number 7 is one that is probably for a lot of people maybe up there as a number 1 pick, and I would argue is the deck building game. My number 7 is Dominion, really the game that started it all, that all other deck builders kind of follow in its footsteps. And it laid out that groundwork so much to the point that I don't even know how to really describe it outside of saying like it is a deck building game, because you are buying cards from separate piles, and there will be a stack of different ones, and you're trying to get money to buy more cards as well as powers that will give you points and everything. And this is definitely It's not my favorite deck building game in the world. It's my number 7, I guess. But I think it deserves its place on this list almost just as for its legacy that it's generated. I think you gotta mention it. You gotta talk about it because it is a big deal. Almost all these other games, I think all of them wouldn't exist if Dominion hadn't come along first. And there's so many expansions. That's one of the great things about it is that there's a lot of different ways to interact with it. And even if you figure a strategy out in one way, you can add in a whole new set of cards and mix things up. And there's like 8 billion variations therein. And then my number 6, appropriate because I feel like it's almost like the kind of the sister game in a weird way to Dominion. And my number 6 is Ascension. And to me, if Dominion is the grandfather of all that style of deck builder with the separate piles, Ascension sort of is that, at least to my knowledge, at least popularized it, of the random lineup and that style of play, which I do in general prefer, I think, in most cases. And it's got nice looking artwork, really, really cool, beautiful cards. And for the same reason kind of as Dominion, I feel like both of those are games that are just have to be talked about because I think they both broke ground in some way. Neither of them are necessarily, again, like my favorite go-tos. I think other games have done both of those styles better since. But I still enjoy sitting down to play both of them now and again. So that's my 7 and 6, Dominion and Ascension.
My next one, coming in at number 6, used to be considered a small deck builder, but I think it has grown quite a bit since, and that's Star Realms. This is another space-oriented one in which you will actually be trying to take out the life points of your opponents. Initially, these came in small boxes that had 4 different groups in them, but since it has grown huge, not only just having the regular mode that I described before, but there are single-player variants, boss modes, teams, and just crazy other combinations. The 4 groups now have hybrids, and the way you can play off each other has changed a bit. It really just has grown partially because of the popularity initially and just such a great deck building game where you can start off really small and cheap in a great way and have fun, but then branch off in so many different weird ways. The entire galaxy is your oyster.
Yeah, that is one that went from cute little purchase, this is great, too. Oh, it takes up 8 shelves.
Yeah.
Depending on what you do.
Definitely. We're starting to get into some of the big ones, and this one goes out to AEG and their Thunderstone Quest. This is actually a re-implementation of Thunderstone. The idea behind it is this fantasy, and you will be going throughout a town, actually moving a piece, and depending on where your piece is, you'll be able to buy certain things, whether it's resources, cards for your deck, or other items, and you can then descend into a dungeon. You'll need different resources, usually lanterns, to be able to go into different rooms. There are plenty of different cards for you to upgrade, different rooms for you to use, bosses for you to battle. And of course, there's a campaign, which is really more just scenario setups. There's nothing that really links them too much. But there's just so much going on. And this is another one that has grown really big. They actually made a big box collector's edition, which I have, and I'm pretty sure it's having trouble holding everything. So if there's something you really want to go all in and go deep and just have so many crazy permutations, this is one to take a look at.
My number 5 is also Thunderstone Quest. So this is
beautiful.
The first time on our list. We are right in sync on this one. And just like you said, I mean, what I love about Thunderstone Quest is the board is a big part of it, while still, I think, keeping the core of the gameplay all about your deck and your hand and your cards. It's still a big part of what you have to do in your decision making is, where do you want to go this round? Are you going to buy something? Are you ready to go into the dungeon? And because that dungeon can have different tiles, there's a lot of different variations there, as well as campaign stuff in this one. So you can gradually introduce new elements, or you can just go crazy and mix them all in. I really, really enjoyed this one. I think this is one of the better. It's like somewhat more in the traditional end as far as most deck building goes, but it has enough extra stuff going on into it that enhances, doesn't detract from everything else. And like you said, it's huge. So I really like Thunderstone Quest. And that brings me to my number 4 pick for my top 10 deck building games. And my number 4 is Clank. And I'm going to go on to say in space. So, so you know, again, I toyed with just making this, it's just the Clank series is my pick for number four, but I'm going to take a firm stance. I'm going to say In Space. This is, you know, the original Clank was all about getting in, getting some treasure, and then deciding how much you're willing to stay in there before you try to get out and the dragon starts getting at you. And the Clank in Space, similar idea, but with a sci-fi setting. And for me, it's a little bit stronger. I like the theme a little bit better. I also like that the board in that one is modular. There's more going on with it that I think makes it more interesting. It just has a little bit more complexity overall that I think, while it does take a little bit longer, I think the original Clank is a bit better for maybe for families or for newer gamers, or even if you just want to have a quicker experience. I think Clank in Space I enjoy more overall. And in terms of, you know, how they do the deck building, it's somewhat basic. It really is that push your luck part of it. Again, bringing the board into play, I think in a way that complements the card play is something that I admire about it.
Number four on my list is probably the oldest, but is still strong, and that's Mage Knight. This is one that I can see some debate over whether it really is a strong deck builder, because you don't really cycle through your deck nearly as much as maybe when you think of something that's core deck building, but it's still an essential part of the game. It is still so much fun to buy up, and when you build your deck and get some weird card combinations off, you have to just be a bit more careful with how you play your cards, you know, and because there's more going on than just the deck building, you're moving around the board, finding out whatever your scenario is, whether it's cooperative, competitive, getting points. It's just such a great game, and considering where it is time-wise, like in the release of board games, I still think it is an extremely strong contender.
Yeah, this is one that we discussed before the show, actually, that I'm glad that it's being represented here. For me, just to make it easier, I restricted my list to really as pure as I could make them, even though, you know, you could argue some of those are a little less pure with board play and everything, but I cut this one out because I said, yeah, it's not enough deck building for me, but I do think it's maybe better than any other game on my list.
My number three pick is not as good of a game.
Well, guess what? Let's put that to the test.
Yeah.
Let's hear it.
Well, it's the DC Comics deck building game. In fact, the whole Cerberus line from Cryptozoic. I just, this to me is pure deck building. That's all there really is. Unless you go into Rebirth, you know, there's a lineup, you're buying cards, you're comboing off with your big ability or the other cards you go in. I do think the Street Fighter one is also a fantastic pick. I think it works out really well and has a lot more player interaction with the attacking and defending, and you can sort of go back and forth with counterattacks and stuff. So if you had to go outside or pick very specific ones besides DC, Street Fighter would be my choice out of the Cerberus engine.
I'm surprised that's your number three, and now I'm curious to find out what your number two is. But we come back to me for my number three pick, and my number three is Friday. Friday is a solo only, a single player deck building card game based on Robinson Crusoe, where you play as his buddy Friday and you're trying to survive on an island. And this, like Clank, has a big push your luck element to it. It's a very, very simple, straightforward game, which is one of the things I like so much about it, is it's a very small deck. I think 18 cards is how many you play with. And when they come up, you decide if you're going to try to take them on, and if you have the cards in hand to defeat, overcome one of those cards, you get to add it to your deck as a card to use later on. Or if you can't, you take some damage, but when you take damage, you also get to remove some weaker cards from your deck. So it's deciding when and how you should do that, and also the different hazard cards have different levels of difficulty. So it allows them to use the same cards multiple times, but depending on what stage of the game you're at, you just look at a different section of the card, and that will determine how powerful it is. It's a really quick playing game. It doesn't take up much space. It's a great one for solo gaming, small box, cheap, easy to pick up, really easy to recommend for a deck building solo game. And another one that has kind of stuck around, stood the test of time, I think, is Friday. Next up is my number two. And my number two is Eon's End, with the, in parentheses, Legacy. It really is Aeon's End Legacy, because that's the only one of this series that I have played. So that's my official number two pick. Although I would, you know, be so bold as to say, kind of extending it to the rest of the series, because they all do share pretty similar gameplay. But Aeon's End Legacy was a fantastic experience. You can actually watch us play through it. We filmed ourselves for all those games as we did it together. I like the cooperative nature of it. I really enjoy, one of my favorite things about it that changes up how deck building works is the fact that you do not shuffle your deck ever, which is easier on the cards and easier on the players. Cuts down on time. That's a great aspect of it. Allows you to puzzle out your deck in a different way than most deck builders allow for, along with a cool set of cards, cool spells that you can get. I like the balance between, you know, protecting your own health, also protecting your town's health. So even if it was just the Legacy experience, which it is, like I said, I can't comment on the other versions of the game. For me, that one standalone is good enough that it makes my number two.
Well, my number two is also Aeon's End, and all right. I actually have played around with the core set, not just Legacy, and yeah, for a lot of the same reasons. The idea of not shuffling your deck actually turns out to make this great puzzling of like, oh, let me actually discard it this way, because I probably, just in case, because I'm not 100% sure, because I'm not good enough to track that stuff, to be like, if I draw extra, what I'll have, but I can try to keep these two cards together. And even though I'm not usually a fan of the here are the sorted piles going on, there's so much going on, and I feel the story and the theme is much better. You have the multiple life points, and the fact you're working together is a lot of fun. And like, you see reoccurring characters, and there's actually each expansion really is a story, including Legacy being like a prequel to everything. It really is just so much fun, and it is such a unique deck experience, building experience, that I'm so glad I finally got into.
Now, I think it's safe to say, if anyone has ever watched our show for any extended amount of time, you probably knew going into this what our number one would be. But it is your turn, so you will get the honor of letting everyone know.
Our favorite deck building game system is going out to Legendary. This initially was Marvel, but has spread to so many other properties. For the Marvel one, you know, we've got so many expansions that have covered almost every hero you can possibly think of. They've even split off into Legendary Encounters, which is, unlike the regular Legendary, a fully cooperative game where we've seen Alien, Predator, and the likes of other crazy creatures.
Yeah, for anyone who doesn't know, the Encounters series of Legendary came out later and has more of a focus on co-op gameplay, as well as finding things as they progress naturally, and more of a slightly less randomized deck as opposed to the fully randomized nature of the most of the traditional Legendary games. And I think in a lot of ways that system does improve on the original Legendary. For me, my personal number one, if I have to hone in on something specifically, I definitely would pick Marvel Legendary as a game by itself, partially just for nostalgia reasons. We've been playing it for so long, and I really love the Marvel characters and the Marvel universe, and there are so many expansions, so that's a big advantage it has. There's just so much variation you can add to it. But in general, just throughout as a system, Legendary to me is kind of the perfect balance of being simple, you know, easy to pick up in the same way many great deck builders are, but with enough depth, even in the base alone, before you add in like all the different keywords and mechanics from later sets, it's enough so it doesn't get boring at all. There's enough there for you to chew on. And again, with all those different variants, there's just so much there that it's one of those games that I know we almost never get tired of playing of.
I think my favorite is Legendary Encounters Alien. I think it just does so much right and has cooperative, competitive, hidden traitor, and only two expansions. You need to have all this mixture. But if I look at Legendary Encounter system versus Legendary, I feel like when you see Buffy and Big Trouble Little China are still fun to play with and mix with the others, when the other encounters have been a much more hit and miss, which is why I think, as you said, the regular Legendary system is probably overall better. And then if you look at those, Marvel is the one that has a lot more weird stuff going on. One of the reasons I also put it up so high on my list in general, compared to not just the encounters, but the whole other deck building games. There earlier on your list, Jonathan, you talked about how there was the grandfather of the like Dominion of the set pile system versus Ascension, which is the full randomness. I feel, while definitely it's closer to the randomness system, it feels like it's a bit mixture of each. You, in the beginning, you choose what heroes you're playing with. So you're going to be shuffling and only seeing those. So you could play a game that's all Spider-Man, you know, all two cost cards that are flipping. You could play with ones that are going to be more aggressive in dealing wounds out to everyone. So you could still get the, I think, the pros of both systems. And not maybe not some of the cons, but enough that I feel like it balances out much better.
It's funny. I actually think our numbers 1 and 2, which we share, I think Aeon's End to me feels like the next evolution of the Dominion style. And I think Legendary is the next evolution of the Ascension style. Both definitely like that same family, but you know, they do borrow maybe a little bit from the other to combine to be something better than that initial incarnation, at least in my opinion. So, and yeah, I think in general, just the Legendary system is a really strong system, and it's been going on for a long time, and it's really popular. So we're not alone in thinking this, but we do happen to share that number one. But otherwise, I think we had some pretty good diverse lists. We had some bigger, more obvious names on there, as well as some more obscure titles that people might not have been as aware of or don't have as much experience with. But before we talk a little bit more about our lists overall, we do, in fact, I want to mention, have a Patreon page.
Do we now?
Which you could, yeah, we do. You can sign up for it for just $1 a month. And we asked our patrons before this video what their favorite deck building games are. So we will look at some of those comments and add those, see how those contrast with our own lists. Dominion was not just mentioned by me, also mentioned by patrons Greg Everett and Aaron Threehane. Aaron also talked about Clank and Star Realm, which also popped up on both of our lists. Brian Wells, as well as a few others, talked about Legendary. Specifically, Brian Wells mentioned Marvel Legendary, so another shout-out for Marvel, which, of course, is really... I mean, that's the one they put all their marketing muscle into for the most part. Hoser40k brought up Xenoshift, which I know is a big one that I have played a little bit of, but neither of us really have much experience with it, but we suspect it is a game we would really like.
Yeah, that was... pretty high. It still is pretty high on my games I wish I was there. I remember you actually played it at one of our earlier Gen Con.
Here's a good mention. Christopher Mason said deck building, the deck building game. You know,
That title alone makes it worthy of being on this list. It just...
yeah, it's a game that really needed to exist. Luke L. shouted out the Harry Potter Hogwarts battle deck building game, which is a co-op one themed around the Harry Potter films. Actually has a campaign where you play through the different movies and things. And I think that's a decently fun one. I never got too deep into it, but I think it's a good choice for especially for families and stuff like that. Falcon Ash K brought up Eminent Domain as well. And also he honed in specifically from the Cerberus engine. He likes the Lord of the Rings deck building game. Didn't specify a Fellowship or Two Towers or anything like that, but Lord of the Rings is his cup of tea.
They're very interesting because each one isn't just, if you played, Jonathan, like the DC deck building game of like they're just different characters and maybe a small gimmick. Like one is you actually have to move the ring across. Another one is there's a ring card. I do say though, The Hobbit, the weakest of them, just like the movies.
That's a shame. And then finally, a couple people, including Simon and Pacey, brought up some games that were a little outside of our purview for the purposes of our lists in this video, such as the Arkham Horror LCG and other LCGs, and even Magic the Gathering. Basically, games where you do all your deck building before you start playing. For the purposes of our lists, we tried to narrow it down by just saying ones where you're building as part of the core gameplay itself.
Yeah.
So a little bit of a different thing. We would have had a lot more contenders if we were stretching it that far. That will be
another top 10.
Perhaps, yes. I don't know if I can be involved in that one because I don't know if I like as many of those.
Yeah, I think yours would be, God.
Well, Journeys in Middle Earth and Gloomhaven and, you know, just be campaign RPG games, I guess. At any rate, so those were our Patreon picks. If you want to get in for our next top 10, whatever that may be, you can sign up. It's in our description. But let's get back to our list. Are there any games that you considered for the list that didn't quite make it that you want to shout out?
Well, one I do want to shout out is Cthulhu Realms. It was actually based off Star Realms from Tasty Minstrel. Same idea, hence the similar names. And I feel the other deck builds do things better, but the one thing I love about Cthulhu Realms is its weird split buying lanes. You pretty much have lanes between the players to your left and right. So it's something so fun. And it's like, I want to take that mechanic into other deck builders.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
That was one that came close, but I haven't played it enough and it could have maybe made this list in the future is the Viscounts of the West Kingdom. Because technically you are building a deck throughout that game.
Hmm. Another one that was on my top 10 list for 2020 is Lost Ruins of Arnak. Mm. And I do really like the way the deck building works in that game and that it's very pared down. But I think, again, for me, I was trying to look at more focused deck building games. That one does do a lot of other stuff within that deck building. And another one I wanted to mention is God of War, the card game, which is one I really, really like. I think it makes great use of that license. But again, I think that deck building, while you definitely do it during the game, it's not so much at the forefront. It's more about this puzzle of the tableau of cards as you play. And so for that reason, I axed it off the list. But
I see what you did there.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. That was honestly not intentional. So he has an axe in the game. But those were a couple that I wanted. I know one that we had talked about as maybe kind of a gray area, but I think it qualifies is Mystic Veil.
Yes, because it is card crafting, and you're technically not adding and removing cards from your deck. You're changing them. You're right. Adding like these see-through cards, and I can't really argue why it's not a deck builder. Like it pretty much captures the exact same feeling. You are upgrading your deck by changing the cards. It's not just the usual buy a card, destroy cards kind of cycle that almost all the rest have.
Yeah, yeah. I do really like the card crafting mechanic. I'm not as big a fan of Mystic Veil, the game itself overall. Although there are a few expansions that I haven't tried that maybe would spice it up that would make me like that one more. I don't know. Deck building is an interesting mechanic because while we do see it done the same way over and over again a lot of the time, there also are a lot of areas within that framework to innovate. I think card crafting is a great example of that. And like we said, sometimes we're not even sure, is this deck building? And I think there is something cool that it's been done so many times that it has, in a way, allowed people to now play with it more because you're so familiar with it. They can iterate on that idea. And hopefully some of the things on our list, I think generally we gravitate towards the deck building games that do more of those innovative ideas as a spin. Although, I did mention a couple, like we said, like Dominion, which are more traditional.
One of the reasons I think to me I love deck building in general is it really is a feeling of progression. And what you do is if you can capture that well, you can bring that to other things. Because, Dungeons & Dragons is a game about progressing through a story and leveling up. So you just do that with a deck involved. And it feels so great when you draw your cards too and you're like, oh, guess what? I built my deck through and I'm ready to just go crazy. And for a lot of people too who maybe don't have the time to do the all the theory crafting and trying out and knowing the full sets when you do your Magics, your Arkham Horror, your LCGs, your CCGs. Being able to do this while playing the game sort of helps cut down the time and still get that same feeling of building a crazy deck.
Yeah, it's a little bit of not quite instant gratification, but pretty fast gratification. You get to really actively see your plan in action and find out whether it was a good plan or not. Now, those are our lists, but perhaps you watching at home have different opinions about where you think the games that we put in our list should be placed, or maybe there's some we didn't even mention that you would like to add into the ring, and you can let us know what those suggestions are. In the comment section right down below, please let us know anything about deck building games that you love or ones maybe that you don't even love that we talked about today.
There's a good chance that maybe that we missed out on this, and once we get a chance to play it, it could rival come back here. Who knows? There's always so many more games to be, whether they're yet to come out or maybe we just didn't see them. And I'm excited to hear about more deck building games that maybe I didn't get the chance to sit down at the table with.
Let us know right down below. And thank you for watching. And stay tuned for more top 10 lists in the future, as well as all the other great videos we always like to put out. Thanks for watching, everybody. I'm Jonathan.
I'm Will.
And this is Roll for Crit.
If you love board game content, do us a favor, like and subscribe, and support us on Patreon.
Keep watching our content to guarantee you'll top deck a good video.